destroy that. You animal, destroy that.
Each of these attacks leaves one question. What heinous crimes could these teenagers have committed that drove the parents to lash out in violence right in the courtroom? We're about to find out soon enough. TJ Lane. For some, an attack is an onslaught of fists, but for others like Thomas Lane III, the parents of his victims didn't need fists. Their words were blistering enough to get the job done.
If I had my choice, you would die an extremely slow, torturous death. You don't deserve to take another breath while my 16-year-old son Danny lies in the cold ground because of your disgusting, selfish, and cowardly actions.
Lane, wearing a sweatshirt with the word killer, made his way to the school cafeteria armed with a .22 caliber handgun. As soon as he got in, he opened fire on the students and had to be tackled by a school teacher and coach before he stopped shooting. Unfortunately, it was too late. Russell King, Daniel Parmator, and Demetrius Hewlin had been shot dead, and two other students were severely injured. Lane was arrested and charged with aggravated murder, aggravated attempted murder, and felonious assault. At his trial, Lane showed no iota of remorse, even right down to his sentencing. In fact, on the day of his sentencing hearing, he walked into the courtroom and quickly unbuttoned his shirt to reveal another shirt with the words, "Killer," sprawled across it, a replica of what he had worn on the day of the shooting. Not even the verbal attacks of his victim's parents could bring out a sympathetic emotion from him.
I hate you for the pain you have caused, Nick. You chased him down the hall and fired the last bullet that paralyzed him.
As the words were fired at him, Lane sat through it all with a smirk.
You are a killer. You are a pathetic excuse for a human being. In fact, you're not even a human being. You don't deserve to be called human. You're a monster, and will forever be titled a triple murderer.
As brutal as these words were, none was enough to break through his appearance of bravado.
If I had my choice, you would die an extremely slow, torturous death. You don't deserve to take another breath while my 16-year-old son Danny lies in the cold ground because of your disgusting, selfish, and cowardly actions.
They all wished he would remain in jail for the rest of his life.
Judge Fury, please don't ever let him on the streets. He is dangerous and has caused way too much pain.
Safe to say, their wishes were granted. In the end, TJ Lane was sentenced to 3 consecutive life sentences without parole. Frank DeLeon Jr. TJ Lane may have only suffered blistering words, but for 19-year-old Frank DeLeon Jr., the family of his victims had no words to spare. Those were left for the lawyers and jurors. As DeLeon awaited sentencing at the Harris County District Court, he was about to get a much swifter and definitely brutal justice right in the courtroom. On January 11th, 2022, 15-year-old Diamond Alvarez left her home with her dog to meet with Frank DeLeon, her boyfriend at the time. According to reports, Diamond had decided to meet up with DeLeon in a nearby park to confront him. She had just found out that he was cheating on her and was even in another relationship. Unfortunately for Diamond, that would be the last day she would be seen alive. Her family sensed things had gone terribly wrong when the dog came back home without Diamond. It didn't help that at around 9:30 p.m., they had heard several gunshots right before the dog returned home. They decided to search for her in the neighborhood, and that was when they made a devastating recovery. The body of Diamond was found in the 15400 block of Park Manor Street. She had been shot 22 times. DeLeon immediately became a prime suspect, and days after the shooting, he was arrested, charged with murder, and posted a $250,000 bond. The decision to let him out on bond deeply enraged the victim's family, and they took to protesting.
It's obvious that the system is broken. It's obvious that the system does not care of its citizens. Until we start acting out, they want us to riot so they can listen to us. They want us to start acting out of character so that they can listen to us. What is the issue? Why is this killer being released?
They want us to start acting out of character. They didn't have to protest for long, though. DeLeon was arrested months later, after he violated his bond conditions. Seeing that he didn't keep to the rules and had even failed to make a court appearance ahead of his trial, DeLeon's bond was forfeited and he was taken into custody. His trial was quite an emotional affair for both the families of the victim and the suspect. Still, no one expected the court proceedings to turn chaotic when Diamond's mother, Anna Machado, went from giving a victim's impact statement to storming in the direction of her child's killer. color. As captured on court cameras, Anna Machado was seen angrily walking towards De Leon before she was quickly restrained by a bailiff. Might have been swift, but things were just getting started. All hell broke loose when Alvarez's uncle charged at De Leon, tackling him to the ground. While deputies struggled to keep the two men apart, De Leon's mother charged at Anna Machado, and another fight broke out, turning the courtroom into a circus. Following a plea deal, Frank De Leon was eventually sentenced to 45 years in prison for the murder of Diamond Alvarez. He is expected to serve at least half of his sentence before he's eligible for parole. Nicolas Cruz. There are killers like Frank De Leon, and then there are those like Nicolas Cruz, a mass shooter who ended the lives of 17 students and wounded 17 others in what is known as the deadliest high school shooting in U.S. history.
You destroy that. You animal, destroy that.
At the 17th Judicial Circuit Court of Florida, Cruz is not only about to face sentencing for his crime, but also witness the fiery pain of his victim's parents as they unleash on him. 17 counts of attempted first-degree murder. Long before he committed the shootings, Nicolas Cruz was known to have behavioral issues since preschool. He was even transferred between schools 6 times in 3 years to deal with these problems. In 2014, he was transferred to a school for children with emotional or learning disabilities, where he was said to have made threats against other students. Unfortunately, this was just scratching the surface of the darkness that dwelled within Cruz. In February 2017, Cruz legally purchased an AR-15-style semi-automatic rifle from a Coral Springs gun store. Before that purchase, he had similarly obtained several other firearms, including at least one shotgun and several other rifles. At the time, it was legal for 18-year-olds to purchase a firearm. On February 14, 2018, Cruz opened fire on students and staff at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School, where he was a former student, and murdered 17 people while injuring 17 others. He then blended in with other students during the chaos that followed and tried to escape on foot, although he was eventually arrested an hour and 20 minutes later. According to what he told a psychologist, Cruz claimed he committed the shooting on Valentine's Day because he believed that no one loved him. On March 7, 2018, a grand jury indicted Cruz on a total of 34 charges, 17 counts of first-degree murder and 17 counts of attempted first-degree murder. On October 14th, a trial was scheduled for the following day, where it was reported that Cruz would plead guilty to the battery charge. Judge Scherer stated she would hold a hearing on October 20th, 2021, where Cruz planned to plead guilty to all counts relating to the shooting to avoid the death penalty. On October 20th, Cruz pleaded guilty to all charges, including murder and attempted murder. On October 13th, 2022, the jury recommended that Cruz be sentenced to life imprisonment without the possibility of parole. Nearly all of the murdered victims' families expressed anger and extreme disappointment toward the verdict, and this was evident in their brutal verbal attacks directed at him.
You destroy that. You animal, destroy that. You took my son away and a teacher away that loved his children. Someone you never met. You never had anything to do with. That's what you did. You're a bastard, you're a freaking animal.
It was clear everyone wanted him dead.
When you die, it is my fondest hope that they take you and burn you and take your ashes and throw them in the garbage dump. You know why? Because garbage to garbage.
Their pain was evident with each word they uttered.
And I will celebrate when you die. I heard you saying that you don't want to suffer. You don't like painful things. You understand that you will suffer and you will go through pain, a lot of pain.
In fact, there were no limits to the harsh words thrown at Cruz.
The only comfort I have is that your life in prison will be filled with horror and fear.
On November 2, 2022, Cruz was sentenced to 34 consecutive life sentences without the possibility of parole, one each for the total number of victims murdered and wounded by Cruz. Ethan Crumbly. Like Nicolas Cruz, 15-year-old Ethan Crumbly would brutally end the lives of 4 students in a school shooting that rocked the state of Michigan and the nation. While Cruz may have killed because he didn't feel loved, Crumbly murdered his victims with no clear motive.
Day by day passes, I hope his life seems more meaningless, lost and forgotten.
Let's head to Oakland County Circuit Court, where this young killer is about to face justice, as well as the attack of his victim's parents, all waiting to get a pound of his flesh. Before the shootings, Ethan displayed signs of depression, which started when his only friend moved away from Michigan at the end of October 2021. According to prosecutors, the family dog died at the same time, which plunged the young teen into depression. As of March 2021, Ethan had already started sending his mother disturbing texts about his state of mind, with claims about demons and ghosts inside the home. He also videotaped himself torturing animals, making Molotov cocktails, and even sketched himself committing a school shooting, an act he had joked about, committing with a friend via text message. It was even reported that he had allegedly kept a baby bird's head in a jar, which he later placed in a school bathroom. One time, a teacher found a violent drawing on Crumbly's desk. It was a drawing of a semi-automatic handgun, pointing at the words, "The thoughts won't stop. Help me." In another section of the drawing note, there was the drawing of a bullet, with the following words above that bullet, "Blood everywhere." Between the drawing of the gun and the bullet was a drawing of a person who appears to have been shot twice and bleeding. Below that figure was a drawing of a laughing emoji. Further down the drawing were the words, "My life is useless." And at the right were the words, "The world is dead." Despite these bizarre and downright disturbing signs, Ethan's parents never tried seeking therapy for their son. Sadly, this would have devastating consequences. On November 30th, 2021, Ethan, armed with a semi-automatic handgun, made his way to Oxford High School, where he attended and began shooting at the students. When the students began fleeing, he methodically and deliberately walked down the hallway and shot into classrooms and at anyone who was unable to escape until he moved on toward another classroom. Due to the quick response by students and staff, Crumbly was unable to actually enter any of the classrooms. Three students were killed at the scene, and eight other people, including a teacher, were injured. A fourth student died in the hospital from his injuries. On December 1st, 2021, he was charged with terrorism, causing death, first-degree murder, assault with intent to murder, and possession of a firearm during the commission of a felony, with the possibility of more charges being added as the investigation continued. On October 24th, 2022, Crumbly pleaded guilty to all of the charges and withdrew his intent to pursue an insanity defense. He also admitted during questioning on that day that his own money was used to purchase the weapon and claimed that the gun was not locked away on the day of the shooting. On December 9th, 2023, Crumbly was to be sentenced. The parents of his victims let him have a piece of their minds first before the judge's verdict.
"For everything that we have experienced that's hard and felt impossible, the shooter, this monster, should have to feel everything hard and painful and impossible for the rest of his life. The closest thing we can get to that is life in prison."
Every word spoken bore the pains each parent had to bear, all because of Crumbly's actions.
"On November 30th, 2021, four beautiful people were taken from this earth and seven others wounded through a senseless act of evil. I believe that the Oxford High School shooter should remain in jail for the remainder of his life and be sentenced to life without the chance of parole."
They wished him the worst in prison.
"Day by day passes, I hope his life seems more meaningless, lost and forgotten."
In the end, he was sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole. Peyton Gendron. Like the last two defendants on this list, 18-year-old Peyton Gendron refused to live like any normal teen, but instead chose the dark embrace of white supremacy. The result? The gruesome shooting deaths of 10 African Americans. During a court appearance, Peyton would face swift retribution at the hands of a victim's family member who couldn't hold it in.
"No, our kid, we never go in no neighborhoods and take people out. Don't do it."
Take your seat at Erie County Court in Buffalo, New York, where this dramatic moment unfolds. Peyton Gendron was a regular 18-year-old white teenager who was referred to as quiet by many who knew him. Even though he exhibited strange behaviors like rarely attending classes or wearing a hazmat suit to class, he didn't particularly pose a threat to anyone. What most of them didn't know was that Gendron was an avowed white supremacist who believed every other race was inferior. In fact, just a day before committing a deadly shooting that would rock the community and nation, he had visited visited Buffalo just the day before and had also researched previous hate-motivated shootings and attacks. A childhood friend also mentioned how the day before the shooting, Gendron had visited his house and left 5 boxes of ammunition. He claimed he needed to leave the ammunition because he was rearranging his own house and would retrieve them later. Back in June 2021, Gendron was investigated for threatening other students at his high school, and a teacher had asked him about his plans after the school year, to which Gendron responded, "I want to murder and commit suicide." Even then, he was referred to a hospital for mental health evaluation and counseling, but was instead released after being held for a day and a half.
When I first saw him shooting, he shot a woman, he shot a deacon, he shot another woman, and then he went in the store and started shooting again.
On May 14th, 2022, 18-year-old Peyton S. Gendron made his way to the Top supermarket on Jefferson Avenue in a predominantly black neighborhood in Buffalo, New York. He began shooting at people in the supermarket, and by the time he was done, 13 people had been shot, with 10 of them dead. All 10 dead victims were blacks.
Oh my God, he shot so many people in there.
Gendron was arrested without accident and charged on both state and federal levels. On November 28, 2022, he pled guilty to 15 state-level counts, which included 10 counts of first-degree murder, 3 counts of attempted murder motivated by hate, criminal weapons possession, and domestic terrorism motivated by hate. On February 15, 2023, Gendron appeared for his sentencing hearing in an emotionally charged courtroom with the victims' families seething with rage and pain, and even his apology did not do anything to ease them.
I'm very sorry for stealing the lives of your loved ones. I cannot express how much I regret all the decisions I made leading up to my actions on May 14th. I did a terrible thing that day.
It was so bad that at some point, a victim's family member, most likely overwhelmed with grief, lunged at Gendron. He had to be taken out of the courtroom before things got really serious.
Go in those neighborhoods and take people out! No, 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 no.
Even the judge had some scathing words for Gendron before she had down her sentence.
There is no place for you or your ignorant, hateful, and evil ideologies in a civilized society.
The young white supremacist was eventually sentenced to 11 consecutive life terms without the possibility of parole, plus an additional 90 years.
There can be no mercy for you, no understanding, no second chances. The damage you have caused is too great, and the people you have hurt are too valuable to this community. You will never see the light of day as a free man.
Gendron's federal trial is to be held on September 8, 2025, with the Department of Justice seeking the death penalty. Gabe Parker. Rounding up is another shooter who, like the other killers before him, didn't think twice before ending the lives of 2 people and injuring 14 others. At the time of the crime, Gabe Parker was only 15 years old. Even his young age couldn't spare him from the brutal onslaught from his victim's parents.
He has no remorse and no conscience. I see evil, pure evil.
Our final case unfolds at Marshall County Circuit Court, where Parker is about to be sentenced. Gabe Parker was a 15-year-old sophomore at Marshall County High School near Brenton in Kentucky. However, things forever changed for him on January 23, 2013, when he opened fire with a Ruger handgun, murdering 2 other 15-year-olds in the school. At 7:57 a.m., as students were gathering in the commons before the start of classes, Parker went to the school's band room to check with his friends before the shooting, to make sure they were not in the area before returning to the commons area and beginning his attack. After the shooting, Parker discarded the weapon, ran to the weight room, and hid with other students. However, a student recognized him as the shooter and immediately alerted a teacher, who then called the police. By the time police arrived at the scene, 2 students, Bailey Nicole Holt and Preston Ryan Cope, both 15 years old, were tragically shot to death, and 18 other people were injured by bullets and the stampede that occurred while Parker had been shooting. During his arrest, police discovered a copy of the Communist Manifesto and a large Winchester sheath knife in his bag. When asked for a motive, Parker stated that he was an atheist and that his life had no purpose, and other people's lives also had no purpose. According to officers, Parker claimed the shooting was an experiment to see how students and society would respond. Gabe Parker, who had turned 16, to be treated as an adult after he was charged with murder and first-degree assault. On June 12, 2020, the day of his sentencing, the courtroom was filled with tension and anticipation. The families of Bailey and Preston, along with other victims, delivered their impact statements, their blistering words a direct attack on Parker.
I don't see good when I look at Gabe Parker. He has no remorse and no conscience. I see evil, pure evil.
Each statement mirrored the pain and anger his actions, lives.
She was the most precious, beautiful, and selfless soul on this earth, and you took her from us.
Even Parker's parents were not left out of the verbal attacks.
Their parenting skills are obviously demented and have raised nothing but a worthless demon.
One thing each family agreed upon was their determination to ensure that Parker would never be released, vowing to attend every parole hearing and fighting to keep him behind bars for the rest of his life.
You're a sorry, low-life demon, piece of garbage, and I can't stand the sight of you, and you will never see the light of day again, and for that I'm grateful.
Gabriel Parker was handed two consecutive life terms with the possibility of parole after 20 years plus an additional 70 years. And with that, we've come to the end of this video of the youngest killers attacked by parents in the courtroom. For more intriguing videos like this, click on the cards showing on your screen, and I'll be waiting.